Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann. The sight of cash-rich Chinese oil and gas companies buying up assets all over the world is hardly a new phenomenon, having been one of the dominant trends in recent years. But even so, two particular deals have struck me in recent days. Firstly, we had CNOOC, China's biggest offshore oil producer, buying Canada's Nexen for a $15 billion deal in an agreed takeover. The same day, whether by accident or design, we had another announcement from Sinopec, China's biggest refiner, that it was taking a 49% stake in the UK North Sea business of Canada's Talisman, that's right, another Canadian company, for $1.5 billion. Joining me today to look at, really in great depth at these deals and why they're different to some of the Chinese deals we've seen in recent years are Olivier Lejeune, London crude editor.
Hello.
And Robert Perkins, London news correspondent. Hello. Robert, I'd like to start with you, I think. Is this really just a continuation of the trend that I talked about in the introduction there about Chinese companies buying lots of overseas assets?
Yeah, let's not forget, these are state-backed companies. It's no surprise the track record they've had over the last almost a decade now, buying up resources, energy-focused resources across the world to feed a growing demand for energy in China. You know, China's surprising growth over the last decade has really underpinned the strength of commodities across the board for many years. Oil and gas is a key part of that. So what you have here is a Chinese company which is really becoming a little more confident to take over on a corporate level. Not a small company, you know, a mid-sized oil and gas player, which we haven't necessarily seen before. There's the obvious parallel of 2009, the failed takeover of Unocal in the US, which hit political problems. So on that scale, on a political scale, it is a step further, or at least a successful step further so far. So I think that's interesting. I mean, the backdrop again for China is that, as we said, is the energy demand is booming. Let's not forget that, you know, China is the world's second biggest importer of oil. Probably likely very soon will become the biggest, overtaking the US in terms of crude imports. And that's a big driver. I think, you know, politically, people really take it to mean that the Chinese government is stated a policy, you know, explicitly or not, that it wants to secure footholds around the world that will allow it access to oil and gas as the economy grows in coming years.
And Olivier, there's an added significance here. Although the two Chinese deals we saw are with Canadian companies, mm-hmm. that both involve North Sea assets. We haven't really seen much Chinese activity in the North Sea.
I mean, it's the first time, I think, on that sort of scale that we've seen China investing in the North Sea.
Yeah, I'd like to come back to you in a bit and actually ask you a lot more, because I know you know an awful lot more about exactly what they're getting in the North Sea. But it's not just North Sea, this deal, particularly the Nexen deal, Robert. They're buying the company lock, stock and barrel if it goes through. Mm. What do they get for their $15 billion?
Well, a nice package of assets. I mean, as you said, it is a Canadian company. Most of the production, all in terms of the value, is actually in the North Sea, but they do have, Nexen does have an amount of oil sands in Canada, which is producing. It has producing and exploration assets in the U.S. Gulf of Mexico, which is of value. Both of these areas, CNOOC is already present, and they'll be expanding their footholds in those areas. North Sea will be an addition, so that's an interesting development there. Nexen also has some exploration assets, particularly in Poland, targeting shale gas. China, it's no surprise, has many licenses which it's looking at now to try and exploit shale gas at home. So there may be a link in there with technology and the way they can develop that. But certainly, in terms of the Canadian connection, the oil sands, I think, is very interesting. The willingness to expand the play there. The deal, I think, with Nexen, if it does go through, I think it brings CNOOC's foreign control of reserves outside China to getting up towards 50% now, which I think is a good a good figure to show how broadly they've been active in foreign acquisitions over recent years.
There is, as you alluded just now or a couple of times, an important caveat here. This is not these are not sort of done deals. They're announced as agreed deals, both of them, both CNOOC's with Nexen and Sinopec with Talisman, but they do need approval. And the fact that this is a full corporate takeover, the Nexen deal now, rather than just a selective asset acquisition, there isn't much of a track record, at least not a very successful one, for Chinese companies here.
Well, this is one of the big issues hanging over this. I mean, as we've mentioned, CNA wasn't successful in taking over Unical, US company, due basically to political issues. The US, was voted down by politicians. So there is a number of political, obviously, and cultural hurdles that Chinese companies come up against when they start to take a large corporate presence outside the country. Now, in this particular deal, Canada has the last word insofar as is this deal in the national interest? Is it of a net benefit to the country? There are other regulatory issues in the UK. They're taking obviously stake in oil fields in the UK. It's interesting. I think people will be looking very closely at how politicians are taking this in Canada. Whether or not there is a backlash, not just politicians, but on a national level, politicians have to take into account, obviously, the will of the people. If there's any kind of rejection of this or suggestion that it's the invasion of a foreign power, these kind of sort of sentiments that sometimes come up, it will be very sensitive. I think one thing that is worth noting is that I think Chinese approaches in recent years has become a little bit more sophisticated on the mergers and acquisition level. I was speaking to an executive of, well, let's say a mid-sized European oil company just this week, who has a quite a big partnership with a Chinese company, saying even over the last 10 years or so, there's been a real development in the way they're dealing with the Chinese partners on a day-to-day level, on operating level. It's not without its difficulties, for example, the language barrier is a lot less, the average age of the Chinese executive is a lot less than it used to be, that there's more cultural affinity there than perhaps was the case before. So there is hope that it shouldn't meet massive resistance on that level. And by all reports, China's also laid the ground a little bit in that way with regulators and politicians over the last years.
Interesting. Olivier, let's look a bit more at the North Sea. As Robert said, it's not the be-all and end-all of the Nexen deal, but it is the biggest chunk of the company's production is in the North Sea. But Nexen doesn't own the whole of the UK offshore sector by any means, but it seems to own something quite significant.
Yeah, well, Nexen owns Buzzard, which is the largest UK oil field. About four times as large as the next biggest field in the UK. So it's quite a significant field as far as the UK is concerned. It produces 220,000 barrels per day, which is, by any standards, a pretty large field, basically.
Okay, but it's not been without its problems, is that right? Every time I read the news, it's Buzzard's got production problems again.
Yeah, it's had, it's first entered production in 2007, so it's a fairly new field, you could argue. It's had a couple of production glitches over the past few years. If you look at a chart of production from the field, we've had a major outage for the field each year in the past 3 years, 2 years or 3 years.
Okay.
And there's also a scheduled maintenance outage this year, so it's going to keep it being that way this year.
Now, Buzzard, as well as the biggest field, it plays a key role in determining what we all think of as North Sea crude prices.
Mm-hmm. It does. Well, Buzzard feeds into the Forties blend, which is a blend of crude oils from the North Sea, from about 70 fields in the UK North Sea. And that blend tends to set the price of the Dated Brent benchmark, which is used for many transactions around the world. So it is a very significant field because it's about 50% of the Forties blend in a very significant blend. Not all crude oils are equal, you could argue. And certainly, 40s is more important than maybe other blends worldwide. So that acquisition, if it goes through, will give CNOOC a say in how the price is set, because there will be an equity holder, they will get cargoes of 40 crudes, and they will be able to market those cargoes to refiners in Europe or around the world, and therefore help set the price.
And they also get, it strikes me, one interesting thing is this is a new part of the world for Chinese companies to be operating in, and to get that understanding of Dated Brent. Robert, I know you've been looking at this. Like, China has something of a growing exposure to Dated Brent, which historically has not been a huge price marker for Asia, but China's buying quite a lot of crude against it.
That's right. I mean, China has a big part of its crude stream coming from Angola, which I think they almost buy about 40% of Angolan crude exports together with Saudi Arabia. Angola's been the biggest supplier of crude for a few years now to China. But when you take the other crude sources as a whole, it's getting getting over a fifth of Chinese crude imports being bought from countries where the crude exports are priced from Brent, essentially. So there is a potential connection there with the interest of Chinese and having a say or being on as part of the team, the parties to production, which forms that price basis, that which is an interesting parallel. Also, I think it's worth looking at Canada. I mean, just to move away from the North Sea for a minute, but I mean, if you look at the long play there, the fact that it's picking up additional oil sands production, influence, and also gas in Canada, looking towards the future. You know, there is an expectation, or some companies at least, that Chinese oil and gas, more of it, could be moving towards China, towards across the Pacific. In coming years, taking advantage of discounted crude, these oil sands crude, which are generally cheaper than U.S. crudes, there's another sort of a long play there potentially for having a say in getting control of cheaper crude streams, I guess.
Yeah.
And how much of a shakeup is would the entry of CNOOC be for the North Sea market?
The North Sea market is a rather small but significant market with. I would say mainly European and American players. If you look at the main companies trading North Sea crude oil, they tend to be large oil majors from Europe or the US. So Total, Shell, BP, or trading houses like Vitol, Mercury, and Trafigura. So it's very significant because it would mark the entry of a Chinese company to the benchmark.
Yeah, could be interesting. And Robert, you've kind of alluded to this, but just finally, we're kind of running out of time, but is this a sign of things to come, this kind of deal? This seems to be on a different scale. We've seen lots of acquisitions, but this looks like a bolder one than before.
Certainly, I think you're right. I mean, it's really, as we've said, the corporate takeover model is not something they've been particularly successful of before in China. If this deal goes through, there are a number of ifs there, it could mark a really watershed in China's ability to gain confidence of regulators around the world in Western countries, take bigger shares in countries that perhaps politically may have, you know, question marks about the way companies are managed. It leaves them exposed to regulators in this case in Canada and the US, so that they'll need to be a certain amount more transparency on that level, which could perhaps give more confidence to regulators dealing with China in the future. On an operating level, I think what it does is, you know, it's another way of getting involved in projects. These are small stepping stones for Chinese companies. Getting perhaps may not be operated as in the case of the North Sea, but the very fact that they're taking non-operating stakes, equity stakes in positions outside China elsewhere, can usually lead to relationships being established, further joint ventures being done on the back of those assets. So I think certainly the industry is expecting more of this. And who knows, potentially at a similar or larger scale in the future.
Well, it's certainly a really eye-catching deal, and I appreciate both of you taking the time to come here today and tell us why. But that's all from this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. See you next time.